begin the day just by reviewing for you the content of the big red card there. But I see I have just only one decent piece of chalk today. So let me just go over what it means. The Figner Eckhart theorem concerns the matrix elements of very reducible tensor operators, TKQ, between two basis vectors of the standard angular momentum basis. The prime gamma J and M on one side and the unprime on the other side. And it says that the dependence of the matrix element on the magnetic quantum numbers, of which there are three, M prime, Q, and M, is captured by a Clebsch-Gordan coefficient that you see over here with M prime, Q and M, the quantum numbers same comparing over here. When I say it's captured by the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient, I mean the original matrix element is proportional to the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient, and the proportionality factor is something that does not depend on those magnetic quantum numbers. In general, it depends on everything else, however. It depends on the gammas and the j's and which tensor operator it is and the k value. This proportionality coefficient is conventional to denote it, as I've indicated up here. It's called a reduced matrix element, and it's got these double bars in it to indicate that it's not an ordinary matrix element. But basically, it's just a way of listing everything else that it could depend on. And the definition of the reduced matrix element is that it's just the coefficient or proportionality factor that makes this equation work. Now, last time I explained the two main applications of the Figner-Eckhart theorem. One is for selection rules, and the other is to actually calculate a lot of these matrix elements when the magnetic quantum numbers over here are variable. So I won't go through that again, but that's what it's used for. As far as selection rules are concerned, it's actually very easy to use it, using Figner-Eckhart theorem. All right. Now, I'm not going to prove the Figner-Eckhart theorem, mainly because it takes too long to write it all out. The proof is in the notes. But I'll try to give you at least a general idea of what's involved in the proof. To get the general idea, let's first suppress this prime bra, which is over here. And just look at this irreducible tensor operator acting on this ket. So we've got TKQ times the gamma JM. So we can describe this product as being an operator that has certain angular momentum quantum numbers multiplied times the ket that has certain angular momentum quantum numbers, namely KQ on one side and JM on the other side. If we let the magnetic quantum numbers be variable, the Q would range from minus K up to plus K, and the N would range from minus J up to plus J. And so you'd end up with a total of 2K plus 1 times 2J plus 1 kets if you did that. Now this is actually very similar to what we do when we're studying Clebsch-Gordan coefficients, when we combine angular momenta, for example, orbital and spin. So imagine, I mean, to be specific, suppose this J is like a spin and the K is like an orbital or vice versa, it doesn't matter. Then in that case, you might consider a product that would look like this. You'd have a KQ state that would represent, let's say, orbital, and a JM state that would represent spin. Being a product of two kets, not a product of an operator times a ket, but with the same quantum numbers. And again, you would have the same number, if you vary the magnetic quantum numbers, you have the same number of total states. And those total states that we get this way constitutes what I call the uncoupled basis in the process of coupling angular momenta. As we know, you can transform this into a coupled basis, which are the eigenstates of total J squared and JZ. And the expansion coefficients of the coupled basis in terms of the uncoupled basis are the Clebsch-Gordan coefficients. In fact, they're exactly the same Clebsch-Gordan coefficients that appear here. And so the idea is that, in a sense, the total angular momentum content, I mean, this is a set of vectors here, and if I vary the magnetic numbers, this is a set of vectors in our Hilbert space. And one can think about expanding this as a linear combination of in terms of angular momentum eigenstates, a standard angular momentum basis. If you wanted to pick out the coefficient of one of those basis vectors, you'd take the scalar product with exactly this bra here. So that J prime M prime would play the role of the total angular momentum. That's just what the role it plays over here. And so the idea is that this set of states with this set when the magnetic quantum numbers run over their allowed values, this set of kets produced in this way has the same cross-transformation properties under angular momentum rotations and so on as the set of kets you get by just multiplying kets. Multiplying an operator times a ket is not so different from multiplying a ket times a ket. By the way, multiplying two operators, irreducible tensor operators, is a very similar story. If I have, a TK1Q1 times a TK2Q2, if you want an example of this, think of a product of the position operator. You remember the position operator is a k equals 1 irreducible tensor operator if you put it into the spherical basis. It's what we call RQ. Well, maybe I've got an RQ times an RQ prime. This is a tensor, like an XI, XJ, but in a spherical basis. Exactly this thing occurs in the quadrupole moment tensor, which I'll say something about later in the hour. Anyway, the point is that this product of operators, again, has the same angular momentum decomposition as a product of ket or a ket times an operator. The rules work in the same way in terms of how angular momentum combine. And that's the basic idea that lies behind the proof of the theorem, is just to exploit these facts. All right. There is one tricky thing, however, which is that looking at these cats here, or that part of the matrix element, which is the same, you'd think that what you'd be doing is forming k times j, like this. But actually, if you look in the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient, it's the other way around, j times k, which is being done here. The fact that these are swapped is purely a matter of convention, and it has nothing to do with the essential ideas. But it just makes it a slightly harder to remember. You have to remember to do this in the right order. This could have been defined the other way around, and it would still be valid, but this is the conventional way of doing it. All right. Now, so that's the review of the Wigner-Eckhardt theorem, and at least some of the ideas involved in the proof. Now, the next thing I'd like to turn to is a special case of scalar operators. If k is a scalar operator, you know it commutes with all rotations. But it's also an irreducible tensor operator with the values k equals 0 and q equals 0. So there's only one value of q and k. And if we consider the matrix elements of the scalar operator in a standard angular momentum basis with the primes on the left side, the scalar operator in the middle of the unprime basis vector on the right side, like this, the Wigner-Eckhardt theorem tells us that there's first of all a reduced matrix element, which is gamma prime j prime, double bar k, double bar gamma j, times the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient, which I'll fill in a moment. The Clebsch-Gordan coefficient, since k and q are equal to 0 here, turns into j prime m prime, scalar product with j 0, m 0, like this. In other words, what one is doing here is taking j cross to 0, j for the states that the k is acting on, and 0 for the k itself. Well, if you combine an angular momentum with some value, a spin, for example, with another angular momentum, which is 0, adding 0 to an angular momentum doesn't change it at all. It's, in other words, with a product like this is trivial. It means that this Clebsch-Gordan coefficient is the new j is the same as the old j. There's only one value that comes out of this. And so this is actually a Kronecker delta j Kronecker delta j j prime and m prime. That's what the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient is. So we fill this in over here, this becomes delta j j prime delta m m prime, like this. And so when applied to scalars, the Wigner-Eckhardt theorem says that the matrix element of a scalar operator, I'll remind you that the most important scalar operators are Hamiltonians for isolated systems, of which we'll see quite a few in the course. The matrix elements of a scalar operator between basis vectors and the standard angular momentum basis are, in the first place, they're diagonal in the J quantum number. Secondly, they're diagonal in the magnetic quantum number. And thirdly, the matrix elements themselves that are left over, which are on the diagonal, are actually independent of the magnetic quantum number M. They do depend on J, as you see. J must equal J prime, or this will be 0. But they depend on the J. They depend on gamma and gamma prime. They're not diagonal in gamma. There's no reason why they should be diagonal in gamma. Gamma is just an extra index that was introduced to resolve the degeneracies of J squared and JZ. And in general, they have no relation to the operator K, for example, in Hamiltonian. So there's no reason why it should be diagonal in the gammas. But it is diagonal in J's and M's, and as I say, it's independent of the magnetic quantum number M. If you like, you can view this as a matrix in the magnetic quantum numbers. To say that it's proportional to Kronecker delta means the matrix is diagonal. However, that doesn't mean to say matrix is diagonal, doesn't mean that all the diagonal elements are equal. But that, in fact, is what happens here. All the diagonal elements are equal. So, in fact, it's a multiple of the identity matrix, as far as the magnetic quantum numbers are concerned. Now, physically, that means, for Hamiltonians, that means the energy doesn't depend on the orientation of the system. It's an easy fact to understand.
But this is how it comes out.
All right. Now, these results can be understood more simply from another argument, which I'd like to give. It doesn't go through all the Bingham-Eckhardt term. Let's suppose we've got a scalar operator, and we know that it commutes with that it commutes with JZ and also with J square. Suppose we're given an operator K which has these commutation relations like this. Then let's work on the JZ first. Let's sandwich both sides of this JZ commutator between the two basis vectors of the standard angular ridden basis. And this then gives us the prime gamma JM on one side. And then the commutator all right on is JZ times K minus K times JZ. And then we've got the unprime gamma JM on the other side. And this is equal to zero because we got a zero over here to the right hand side. Now here we can let this one JZ act to the left and the other JZ act to the right, and the result is that we get M prime minus M times the matrix L prime gamma JM on one side, K in the middle, and then gamma JM on the other side. This is equal to zero. So what you see by just playing with the commutator is that either M equals M prime or else the matrix element is equal to zero. That's equivalent to saying that the matrix element is proportional to the Kronecker delta. Likewise, if you did the similar game with J squared, you find that the matrix element is diagonal also in the J quantum number, same argument. We'll see this argument again later on. However, these arguments by themselves don't tell you that the matrix element is independent of the magnetic quantum number. That takes an extra argument, and in fact, it doesn't even follow from just these two commutation relations. It really requires the full rotational invariance of K that's became K must commute not only with these two operators, but also with Jx and Jy, which don't appear just here. That means it commutes with all rotations. Well, in particular, if it commutes with Jx and Jy, it commutes with the raising and lowering operators. So let me show you the effect of that. I want to do that. Actually, I think, let's see. Yeah. Maybe what I'll do is, here's what I want to do. Let's leave this discussion with general scalar operators at this for now, and just say that the Wigner-Eckhardt theorem it makes a stronger statement than just these two commutator arguments, because it says that the matrix elements are independent of M. If the Hamiltonian, I'll make this further remark, but if the K were a Hamiltonian and you wanted to find energy eigenvalues, then what you need to do is to diagonalize this matrix since it's not in J, this is hard to diagonal in J, but you need to diagonalize it in the gammas. Gamma here is some arbitrary basis. And if you do, you'll find the energy eigenvalues. But the result will be that the energy eigenvalues won't depend on the magnetic quantum numbers. Again, this is physically the independence, the fact that the energy is independent of the orientation. Now, we've seen a special case of this already in central force motion, where the energy eigenfunctions have the form of NLM, but the energy eigenvalues have the form of NL, like this. And we derive this by working through the radial Schrodinger equation. What I propose to show you now is that a very similar conclusion applies to any isolated system, not just the central force problem. You could make it much more complicated. You could add spin orbit effects and other relativistic effects. You could include the magnetic interactions with the nucleus, which is the hyperfine effects. You could make it a multi-particle system, so you've got more than one electron. You could include the dynamics of the nucleus, so its protons and neutrons interact. You could make a very complicated problem. The conclusion still holds is that the energy levels is that you can write the energy levels in terms of an Angerman quantum number and another one, which labels the energies, but they don't depend on the magnetic quantum number. And that's a general conclusion. So now I'll show you how that general conclusion follows from the theory we've developed so far. So it works like this. I'll speak of a Hamiltonian because that's the most important application. We'll assume it's a scalar, so it commutes with all rotations and it's an isolated system, but possibly a very complicated one. That means in particular it commutes with all three components of J, and as a result, it commutes also with J squared and JZ. And so we get a collection of three operators on any isolated system of any complexity which commute with each other. Therefore, they possess simultaneous eigenstates. Now, one of the ways to find those eigenstates, at least in principle, is to start by diagonalizing J squared and JZ. We
with what we call the quadrant numbers J and M. This is the total angular momentum for the system and the total JZ. Let's call the eigenspace of J squared and JZ with eigenvalues J and M. Let's call it EJM, like this. This is, in general, multidimensional. In fact, usually it's infinite dimensional. This means the total Hilbert space, then, is decomposed into orthogonal subspaces, each of which is characterized by the JM values. We write it this way, as the sum on J and M, where it's really a direct sum and not an ordinary sum. This direct sum just means orthogonal subspaces. Then to find the energy eigenvalues, what we do is we just diagonalize the Hamiltonian in each of these subspaces. And if you do that, you're going to get some energy spectrum, for a different energy spectrum in general for each of these subspaces. Now, for simplicity, let's suppose that spectrum is discrete. And moreover, let's assume that it's non-degenerate. That's usually true, but let's make it as an assumption. So then we can label the energy eigenvalues on a JM subspace by another quantum number we'll call n goes 1, 2, 3, and just counts them in ascending order. That's all it does. This means that the energy eigenstates then can be labeled by these three quantum numbers, so that H acts on NJM, brings out an energy, and the energy depends on NJM, and acts on the multiplying NJM. The reason the energy depends on NJM is we're diagonalizing Hamiltonian in each of these space subspaces separately, and N was just the sequence number in that subspace. So based on everything I've said so far, there's no reason why the energy shouldn't depend on N. However, I'm now going to show you that if you have full rotational invariance, in fact, the energy is independent of N. It works this way. Let's apply a lowering operator to this equation. Let's apply J minus HNJM on the left. And if H commutes with all three components of J, then I can commute these two through, and put the H on the left and the J minus on the right. J minus will act on the NJM, and so we'll bring out a square root, the famous square root, which will be J plus M times J minus M plus 1. And then we've got H adjacent to NJM, like this. Did somebody steal the eraser here? Let's see. Looks like they did. Well, I can't live without the eraser. Let's see if I got one here. Excuse me, I'll find an eraser. Okay. If you allow me to use my eraser, HS on NJM, it just brings up the eigenvalue, which is an energy, in as we're assuming, in JM. And it multiplies. Oh, excuse me. Let me go back to where we were. We run through it again. J commutes with H. I'm applying J minus. I'm applying J minus to the left side of this equation. I'll commute the J minus through the H. Let it act on NJM. That will lower the value of M, so I've got NJ comma M minus 1. This is being acted on by H, so that brings out an energy, which is E sub NJ comma M minus 1. Here we're having an open mind, and allowing for the energy to depend on the magnetic quantum number. So that's J minus acting on the left-hand side. Now, letting J minus act on the right-hand side, the energy is just a number, so the J minus just runs over the ket, and what we get is ENJM times the same square root times the same ket, which is lowered by one magnetic quantum number, M minus 1. And so if you look at these two equations, the square roots cancel, and the kets are the same, and the only thing that's different are the energy levels. And so what you see is that ENJ comma M minus 1 is equal to ENJM. The result is that the energies are the same for M and M minus 1. In fact, by induction, it shows that all the energies are the same for all values of M. The energies don't depend on M. So go back to this original statement here. We can drop the M. And you see we have a generalization of the fact that we learned for central force problems. This is that in any isolated system, the energy levels are characterized by an angular momentum quantum number, and possibly generally other quantum numbers, but they don't depend on the magnetic quantum number. All right. Now, what that means is that even if we take a very complicated system, it means that the energy levels, what you call energy levels, are actually generally degenerate energy eigenspaces characterized by an angular momentum, and they have a dimension of 2j plus 1. In other words, there's a degeneracy This is the degeneracy of 2J plus 1 fold degeneracies that arise on the basis of rotational invariance. All right. Let me give you an example of this. Actually, you can get an example. It's just a hydrogen atom or other set of force problems, but I'll give you a much more complicated example just so you can see how the idea carries through more complicated systems. Let's talk about the iron 57 nucleus. Iron, I think, is 26. Isn't that as easy as 26? And so that means the number of neutrons is equal to 31 in iron 57. This is a 57-body problem in nuclear physics with protons and neutrons, and people don't even understand the forces very well, so the Hamiltonian is complicated too. What can we say about it? Well, what we can say about it is that the energy levels are going to be characterized by an angular momentum quantum number, what we call the spin of the energy level. But it's really the spin is really the sum of the orbital and spin angular momentum of all the constituent particles in the nucleus. And that energy level is going to, if I call the spin I, I is the usual number for denoting a nuclear spin, the energy level will be 2i plus 1 fold degenerate. And in particular, this has got to be true for the ground state of the nucleus. So here's the ground state of the iron 57 nucleus. Let me just call it iron 57 like this. And this is actually as an I equals 1/2 level. Iron 57 is used in the Mossbauer effect, and I'm not going to explain the Mossbauer effect in detail. It's not my purpose here, but let me give you at least some background on it. There are some other levels here. There's one level up here which has, there's an excited state of the iron 57 nucleus that has I equals 3/2. This is called, let's call this 57 iron. Let's call this with a single star like this. The energy difference between here is about 14 kiloelectron volts. There's another nucleus, another excited state, let's call it 57 iron double star. It's at a higher energy. It makes transitions both down to the ground state and also down to this intermediate state. All of these nuclei are unstable, except for the ground state. The way one normally produces this iron 57 double star is you get a further decay up here coming from cobalt 57. And so if you have a sample of cobalt-57, it undergoes this decay, produces some for a brief period of time these excited states as it rattles down to the ground state. It's this 14 keV transition that's the most important one in the case of the Mossbauer effect. This is a doubly excited state, by the way, has let's see, here I'll fill this in. The first start state has I equals 3/2, and the double start state has I equals 5/2. So these are the spins, as we would say, of these different states. Now, if you think of the iron 57 nucleus as a mini-body problem, what's indicated here is just three bound states of the system. But there's other bound states up there. They go on up. There's an enormous number of bound states of spectra of nuclei. And I'm just talking about the bound states now. Can be extremely complicated. For heavier nuclei. And then above that, there's unbound states. There's a continuum in which the protons and neutrons are separated. So that's the Hilbert space for the iron 57 nucleus, and it's an enormous space. It has wave functions with many, many variables in it. But nevertheless, the ground state itself is a state that actually just consists of two different states. There's the energy of the ground state, there's the I, and then there's the MI quantum number. The basis vectors that span the ground state could be labeled by this. If it's understood that I'm only talking about the ground state, I don't need any other labels in it. If I want to have another label in it, I can put an N here. So this is maybe N equals 1. We call that N equals 2. That's a different state. But if we're only talking about the ground state, we can suppress the N and just talk about the I M I. Now, when we talk about magnetic resonance and spins in magnetic fields, we consider the spin Hilbert space, which I call E spin, which was just basically the span of the basis vectors that look like this, IMI, where I runs from MI runs from minus I up to plus I. I think we call this S instead of I, but it's conventional in nuclear physics to use I for this nuclear spin. It just means the spin of the particle. And this is a finite dimensional space, and on this space we wrote a magnetic moment that's proportional to the spin operator with proportionality factors. And then we took it from there, the Hamiltonian is minus mu dot b. But notice that what we're doing, insofar as the iron nucleus is concerned, is we're really only considering a very small subspace of the entire Hilbert space. What allows us to neglect all the rest of this? The answer is that the energy differences are rather large. The mu dot b interaction of an iron 57 nucleus in any reasonable magnetic field is a very small energy compared to this 14 keV. So you might as well just ignore this and just look at this tiny, tiny subspace of the nuclear Hilbert space. That's in effect what we did. And this, by the way, is the explanation why, for at least for composite particles like nuclei, it's the reason why, in dealing with magnetic resonance kinds of problems, why we can just assume the Hilbert space consists of just a single irreducible subspace under rotations characterized by a single angular momentum quantum number. It's because it's the ground state of the system. And because for systems that are isolated, all the energy levels, including the ground state, are characterized by an angular momentum quantum number, and they've got a 2j plus 1, or I's notation in this case, degeneracy, full degeneracy. Okay? So those are some of the lessons that come out of this. All right. This fact that the spin changes on going from the 3-halves to the 5-halves, this transition is an electromagnetic transition. It means it emits a photon. And the photon carries off, as you see, one unit of angular momentum. It's very similar to the dipole transitions in atomic physics. All right. So this is some of the lessons that come from the fact that the Hamiltonian is a scalar operator. All right. Now, the next thing I'd like to discuss today is a somewhat different topic. This is going to come up in this week's homework, so I want to give you preparation for it. I want to talk about quadrupole moment operators. So let me begin by reviewing some things from classical electromagnetism. Let's suppose we have a charge distribution which is localized. Let me call it rho of r, is a charge density. Let's put a coordinate system x, y, z here somewhere in or near the charge distribution. Let's denote positions inside the charge distribution by a prime position vector, call it r prime. So in fact, I'll call this rho of r prime here like this. Somewhere out here, we have a field point where we want to measure the potential. Let's call this r. We want to measure the potential of the charge distribution of the field point. So we seek, let's call it capital phi as a potential, capital phi of r. Well, by electrostatics, this is the integral over the source distribution, d cubed r prime, times the charge density, rho of r prime, times the Coulomb denominator, which is 1 over the distance between the source and the field point, like this. And if you like SI units, you can put in the ugly 4 pi epsilon naughts if you want, but I'll leave them out. Now, the way I set this up, we'll imagine the charge distribution is localized and the field point is far away from it, so that the magnitude of r is much greater than the magnitude of r prime. R prime is a variable of integration, but it has, but it's bounded by the dimension, the size of the charge distribution. So that means we can expand this Coulomb denominator in powers of r prime over r. And if you do this, here's the expansion you get. The first term is just 1 over r, and the next term is this, it's r vector over r cubed, dotted into r prime vector. The next term is this, it's the factor of 1 over 2 r to the fifth, is the sum on I and j, xi, xj, let's say r vector here is x1, x2, x3, and let's say r vector prime is the prime version of that, x1 prime, x2 prime, x3 prime. So it's the sum of I and j of xi, xj, and then this is multiplied times 3 x prime I, x prime j, minus delta ij times r prime squared. And through second order, this is the expansion of this Coulomb denominator. You get it just by straightforward Taylor series. I won't do the algebra. Now this is under an integral, so when you integrate over r prime, you need to do the r prime integral. For the first term, you just get integral. Here's the integrals you get. For the first term, you get integral d cubed r prime rho of r prime. That's just the total charge, which I'll call lowercase q. The second integral, you get d cubed r prime rho of r prime multiplied times this r prime vector, which appears here. That's the charge-weighted position vector, which is also called the dipole moment vector. I'll call that d. That's just characteristic of the charge distribution. At second order, you need to do the prime integral over this quantity in the parentheses. We get integral d cubed r prime of rho of r prime multiply times 3 x prime I x prime j minus delta I j times r prime squared. And this is conventionally called the quadruple moment tensor, and it's called QIJ. Right? Now, so on doing the integral then, what we get is that 5r, the field point, is equal to the total charge Q divided by the radius. That's just the obvious Coulomb term. Then we get the dipole moment dotted into our vector over r cubed. Then we get 1 half plus 1 over r to the fifth times sum 1 I and j of x I x j times the quadruple moment tensor Q I j. And through second order, that's what it is. Now, about this tensor Q I j, this is obviously a symmetric tensor, and it's also traceless. The tracelessness just comes from doing the Taylor series expansion of the Coulomb denominator. It's not an accident, but it just comes out if you do it. To say that it's traceless means that if I sum on I and j, I get 0. So if we sum on I and j on this term here, we get 3 times r prime squared, because you said I equals j at sum. If you sum the second term on I and j, well, that means you've taken the trace of the identity matrix, which is 3, so it's minus 3 r prime squared, and the result is 0. So the QIJ is a symmetric and traceless tensor. Well, as I explained earlier, that's actually a k equals 2. In class E and M, this is not an operator, so I can't really speak of irreducible tensor operators. But it corresponds to a k equals 2, or a 2 angular momentum, a quantity of angular momentum of 2. There's 5 independent components in a symmetric and traceless tensor. And by doing linear combinations, they can be put into the form of a Q value running from minus 2 up to plus 2. All right, this is the Cartesian form of the tensor rather than the spherical form. All right, anyway, this is the QIJ. Now, there's an interesting thing you can do with this expression for the potential. Let me move the QIJ over a little bit to make space. Allow me to multiply and divide through by 3, so I put a 3 here, and this becomes a 6 down here if I do that. The interesting thing you can do is you can take this 3xixj, and you can subtract off the trace of that, which is delta ij times r squared, and put an extra term in there, and it doesn't change the answer. It doesn't change the answer because this delta ij term contracted against q gives the trace of q, which is 0. So actually, this term doesn't do anything to the answer, doesn't change it. However, what it does do is it shows that the second order contribution to the potential now involves a complete contraction of one k equals 2 tensor with another k equals 2 tensor. They're both at the same point, both symmetric and traceless. This one involves the source point, this one involves the field point. All right. Anyway, so this is one of the ways that the way that the quantum moment tensor arises in classical right now. Here's where it gets applied in, for example, nuclear physics. Because again, let's suppose we've got a localized charge distribution, rho of r. Here I'm really thinking about the nucleus. There's a coordinate system here, x, y, and z. And let's take a field, let's take a point here, r in the charge distribution. I won't prime it this time. Let's suppose we have also some potential coming from external charges somewhere else, but they produce this potential phi external. Now, on this blackboard, I'm just going to call this phi of r because I get tired of writing external, but this is not the same phi as in the blackboard above. Blackboard above, the phi was the potential produced by the charge distribution. Here, it's an external potential which is interacting with the charge distribution. In nuclear physics, the idea is that pi external would come from the electrons or elsewhere, or even an applied electric field in the laboratory, and the rho of r is the nucleus. All right, so what we would like to find is the energy of interaction of the nucleus in the presence of this external electric field. So to do this, the energy in classical theory of a charge distribution and an external potential is called a W, is the integral over space and the charge density, rho of r, times the potential. That's all it is. So what we do is, to put this in more convenient form, is to expand the potential about the origin. If you think of a nucleus, the range of the variable r is actually very, very small. And so it's reasonable to expand the external potential, which is slowly, presumably slowly varying over the extent of the nucleus, around the center of the nucleus, or some origin of the nucleus. And if we do this and we just make this a Taylor series, this becomes phi 0 plus the radius r dotted into the gradient of phi plus 1 half, I'll write it this way, sum on I and j of x I x j times the second derivative of the external potential with respect to x I x j evaluated at 0, and I'll stop there because you can keep on going, obviously. And if we do this, and you see the integrals over the charge density can be done, we first of all have just the total charge Q itself, so W is equal to Q times phi evaluated at 0, that's the first term. As far as the second term goes, you've got the charge weighted radius R, that's the dipole moment, so it becomes plus the dipole moment D dotted into the gradient of phi evaluated at the origin. There's a quadrupole term we'll come to in a moment. Before I do that, allow me to observe that the gradient of phi is, of course, minus the electric field evaluated at the origin. So let me write this term in slightly different form as minus D dotted into the electric field. This is the external electric field evaluated at the origin. And now you see the energy of the dipole in an external field. So now it's an electric dipole, but it's minus D dotted into E. As far as the second order term goes, let me take this this expression, before I do the integrals, let me take this expression and massage it a little bit. Let's multiply and divide by 3, so I get 1/6 of 3xixj. Let's also use the fact that we'll assume the charges are far away, so that the sources of the external potential are away from the nucleus. If that's the case, then by the Laplace's equation, the Laplacian of phi is 0. And so that means that this tensor is actually traceless because the Laplacian is the trace of this tensor. And so in this form here where I've got the second derivative, I can subtract off the trace with a 1/3 factor, delta ij, times what's really the Laplacian of phi, because that term is 0 anyway. But the result is that I have a symmetric and traceless tensor here. And now, having done that, I can use the same trick as before. I'm multiplying this by 3xixj, since the thing in the square brackets is symmetric and traceless. I can subtract off the trace of this term. So, to make a long story short, this whole thing can be written this way as 1/6 the sum on I and j of 3xixj minus delta ij r squared times the whole thing in the square brackets here. And the point of this is that I'm now doing integral over the density. When it makes its appearance, it's the same quadrupole tensor that appeared in the other problem. And so the net effect of this is the energy of interaction of the nucleus with the external field is Q times phi evaluated at the position of the nucleus minus the dipole moment vector dotted into the electric field evaluated at the center of the nucleus, plus 1/6 the sum of I and J, the quadrupole moment tensor of the nucleus, multiplied times the second derivative of the potential evaluated at xi and xj, with respect to xi and xj, evaluated at 0, like this. And so this becomes the expression for the energy of the nucleus in the presence of the external field. This is almost all I want to say about this for now. It's just the setup for a homework problem. But I want to add just one more thing, which is that it can be shown that the dipole moment of the nucleus vanishes. And this comes from the conservation of parity and time reversal, which we'll talk about later on. But as a result, this term disappears. And this is why the quadruple lemma term is so important, because it's the first non-vanishing correction to the Coulomb interaction, which is the obvious part. And this gives rise to additional contributions to what's called the hyperfine structure of the atomic spectrum, which I will say more about later on. All right. So that's all I want to say about quantum moments. Maybe I'll write up some notes on the end. All right, I'll do that. All right, I'd like to turn to a new subject now, which is that of parity. This puts the end to our study of rotations, and all this work we've been doing on rotations, we've been talking exclusively about proper rotations. Proper rotations are rotations that belong to the group SO3, and that just means that they are orthogonal matrices with determinant plus one. It means as operations on space, they preserve the handedness of a coordinate system. They don't flip it. Right-handed to left-handed. Allow me to introduce now a certain operation. So the geometrical setup I want to invoke now is the same one that we used earlier in talking about classical rotations. That is to say, we'll posit some inertial coordinate system x, y, z in ordinary space, and we'll refer operations to this coordinate system. So before we used rotations, were rotations about the origin of this coordinate system. Now what I'd like to do is introduce an operation I'll call P, which in words we'll define, we'll call the spatial inversion of operation. And what it does is it takes a vector and just maps it into minus itself. Spatial inversion, because if you start here with the vector R, you just go to the opposite side, vector minus R. So you just reflect it through the origin. If we write this as a matrix, P is a matrix with minus ones on the diagonal. Zeros in the off diagonal, in other words, just minus the identity. You can see that the determinant is equal to minus one. It's also an orthogonal matrix, so this is an example of an improper rotation. So we're talking about improper rotations now. Right. Now, previously we're talking about proper rotations. When we switched to quantum mechanics, we were interested in the unitary operators that act on quantum mechanical systems, which implement the classical rotations. So we can write this way, is that there's some mapping that takes a classical rotation and converts it into a unitary operator acting on our quantum system. Depends on the system what the operator is. So let's assume we have some quantum mechanical system around. What I'd like to do now is to do something similar for the case of the spatial inversion operation, which exists at the level of classical geometry, spatial geometry, to convert this into an operator which we'll call pi that acts on our Hilbert space. And the problem is to find the operator pi is. This is a similar task to what we did earlier when we were looking for what the operators u of r were, although this is now a much simpler task because there's only one p and there are lots of r's. So what we did before in finding the u of r's was we said the u of r should reproduce the multiplication law of the classical rotations. We're going to use a similar criterion for finding the operator pi. So let's review then, what are the properties of the spatial inversion operator at the level of geometry in three-dimensional space? Here are the principal ones that we want. First of all, if you take the operator p and square it, you get the identity, as is obvious from reflecting through the origin twice. The next thing is that p commutes with any rotation, any proper rotation. And this is also obvious because p is just minus the identity matrix, so the identity matrix commutes with everything. It actually commutes with all operations, not just rotations. So these are the principal properties. Let's borrow those into quantum mechanics, and so we'll end up with requirements or postulates on the operator pi, requirements for pi. Well, the first requirement is that it should be unitary, and we make that requirement because we expect symmetry operations to preserve probabilities. We did something similar with our rotation operator. Secondly, let's require that the square of pi be equal to the identity, because that's what happens for the spatial inversion operation. And then thirdly, let's require that pi commutes with rotation operators, because it does so at the classical level as well. This is for all RNSO3, all proper rotations commute with that. These are our three requirements on the parity operator pi. Now, these three requirements don't uniquely determine pi, but they narrow the possibilities down rather considerably. So, depending on the system, it becomes possible to find an explicit formula for pi. Let's begin with the simplest case, which is a spinless particle in 3D. In which the wave function is psi of r, as we know. We know that if we apply a rotation to this, this gets mapped into psi of rotation inverse multiplying by r. What do you suppose should be the definition of the action of parity on a wave function? Well, it's logical that we should use p inverse. Here's the p inverse acting on the radius vector, but p inverse is the same as p, it's minus identity. So this becomes psi of minus r. So that's a guess for the action of parity, as was this guess, as a matter of fact, for the rotations. There's another way of viewing this. Instead of looking at wave functions, let's look at kets. Rotation operator u of r acting on a ket position operator. What it does is just rotates the position of the ket. And so likewise, it's a good guess that pi acting on the position eigenket should take it into minus the eigenket of the spatially inverted position. These two statements here on acting on position eigenkets are completely equivalent to the two above the line, which refer to wave functions. Right. Now, so this is a guess for a definition of pi. Let's see if it satisfies our requirements here. First of all, is it unitary? The answer is yes. An operator is unitary if and only if it preserves all scalar products. So let's just look at the norm of the wave function of a parity inverted wave function psi of minus r. This would be integrating over all space. This is the absolute value of psi of minus r quantity squared. So just by doing a change of variable, taking r and minus r, this is equal to the integral d cubed r of psi of plus r quantity squared. And so the norm of the wave function is preserved. I think this is clear anyway from geometrically what this does. So it is indeed a unitary operator. Secondly, is it squared equal to 1? And the answer to that is yes. Obviously, if we did this operation twice, we'd flip the sign twice. So its square is equal to 1. Thirdly, does it commute with all rotations? The answer to this is again yes. Let's just do it in different orders. Let's take psi of r as an initial wave function. Let's apply, first of all, a rotation operator called u of r. Then this turns into psi of r inverse r. And then let's apply parity by this provisional definition. This becomes psi, but it just takes r and replaces it by minus r, so we get psi of minus r inverse r like this. And if you do this in the reverse order, psi of r applying parity first, this goes to psi of minus r. Applying the rotation next, this goes into psi of minus r inverse r. And so they agree, and we see that this parity operator commutes with all rotations. Of course, if an operator commutes with all rotations, that's our definition of a scalar operator, and we can say that one of these requirements or postulates for the parity operator is that it should be scalar. That means, in particular, if it commutes with all rotations, it commutes with infinitesimal rotations, and therefore it has to commute with the angular momentum of the system, J, whatever it is. It's just another way of writing property 3, we can call this 3A and 3B if you want, they're equivalent to each other. But in the particular case, if we're talking about spinless particles in 3D, the angular momentum is, of course, the orbital angular momentum. And so it follows from what we've done that pi, in fact, for this particular case of a spinless particle in 3D that it can use a orbital angular. This is the commutation relation you can check directly from the definition of how it acts in wave functions if you want to. You can just apply the differential operators and we'll see this works. But it's a necessary consequence of the commutativity of the rotations. All right. So we'll take this as our definition of parity then for spinless particles in three dimensions. Now, the general strategy here is to study the properties of the parity operator, and then we'll turn to the question of what happens when Hamiltonians commute with parity, when they commute with parity, when they don't, and what it means when they do. So right now we'll be working on just the properties of parity. Next question is one about spin. Let's take it one step at a time. Let's talk about a case in which it's only the spin of the particle that we're interested in, and we ignore the spatial part. So in this case, our Hilbert space E is the span of just the spin eigenspace, or the spin space Sm like this, where m goes from minus s up to plus s. All right. So now the question is, what does the parity do to one of these states Sm? Well, we use the fact that the parity has to commute with the angular momentum of the system, which is S. That's the consequence, that's 3D up here. So, let's take a look at, first of all, the case of S sub Z. So, if we apply S sub Z to pi acting on Sm, this is the same thing as pi times S sub Z acting on Sm, which is m times pi acting on Sm. And so you see pi acting on Sm is actually an eigenstate of S sub z with eigenvalue m. But there is only one state in this Hilbert space that has such an eigenvalue of S sub z. So this must be equal to, must be proportional to Sm, where c is some proportionality factor. In other words, all of the basis vectors of the standard angular minimum basis in the spin space are eigenspaces of parity with some eigenvalue I'm just calling C here. Well, the fact that the parity operator squared is equal to 1 means that the eigenvalues must be equal to plus or minus 1. So this C value here becomes plus or minus 1. Well, let's call it C here, which equals plus or minus 1 like this. Well, I'm running out of time. I mean, I am out of time, so I want to stop. I have to stop. Let me just say that it's too bad to stop right here, because it's just in the middle of this argument. The next step of this argument is to show that these eigenvalues of the parity operator for these basis states are actually independent of them. And thus, there is a single eigenvalue, which is plus or minus 1, that applies to the entire spin space. That's the next conclusion. In fact, it's exactly the same conclusion that we made earlier when talking about Hamiltonians, that the energy eigenvalues are independent of the magnetic quantum number. Here's a pi is a scalar operator, so its eigenvalues don't depend on n either.